And of course, next speaker, we have Dr. Ranil Gunarathne, R.D. Gunarathne, one of our own from Colombo University. He was in the chemistry department. Of course, he just retired again a few months back. Though he retired, he's not 65 yet. I should mention that. And I just want to remind him that even though Harini took a swing at Disarum, the St. Thomas's, I hope Aldi wouldn't react to it. He's a product of St. Thomas's College. So anyway, to speak about the quality, integrity, and productivity of the intellectuals, please, Dr. Gunarathne. Let me make a small announcement about the folders also. The two folders that you have, one for to get your information in and the other one for the questions. Please, once you write yours down, pass it around. Don't keep it with you. Then the others will not get a chance to write the questions or write their information. Thank you.
Thank you, Tilan, for that very kind introduction. Good afternoon to all of you, my colleagues, or perhaps I should say, in some cases, my former colleagues. I was actually given a rather difficult topic. I wasn't sure whether I should thank the organizers for dragging me out of my comfortable retirement, like Professor Uyangoda, in order to deal with the following topic, which I was told was internal crises in the university, the quality, integrity, and productivity of the intellectual. And the reason why this topic is a little difficult is that it amounts to self-criticism. In other words, while the other speakers have the privilege of criticizing government policies or social conditions or what have you, I have to criticize you and me. Okay, I accepted the topic. With the full realization that I may end up having to avoid some brickbats at the end of it. One of the nice things about being retired, of course, that you can say fairly blunt language whatever you want without worrying about how it's going to affect your career afterwards. Of course, I think those of you who know me know that I would have been blunt anyway. So it's a fairly difficult topic, and I hope I will be able to do justice to it in 20 minutes. I'm sure Tilan will give me a few extra minutes if necessary. Let me start with a couple of definitions. Since the word crises appears in the topic, I thought I should be very clear on what a crisis is. Well, the dictionary defines a crisis as a time when a difficult or important decision must be made. There is an implication that it's a turning point. And from that point of view, I'm not sure that we are having a crisis in the university. We do have problems. There are ongoing problems, there are chronic problems, as far as quality, et cetera, is concerned. But right now, I don't think there are crises, and I hope to God I'm right, because I don't see anybody in this country ready to make a difficult or important decision regarding the quality of university education. And that brings us to another word, quality. What does quality mean here? See, quality is a very intangible, very subjective term. It means different things to different people. Some people attempt to quantify it, to define it in measurable terms. I personally think that doesn't work. Because to me, it's basically attempting to quantify the value of a human being, not an easy thing to do, but we do it anyway. We have point schemes for promotion. I remember last year serving with Professor Uyangoda on a committee that addressed the most recent proposals for such a point scheme, and it was fun, but I never really believed in it, I must tell you. I think most people, however, can recognize quality when they see it. It's intangible, but it's there. It's a very real thing. So how does all this work within a university? Despite what Tilan said a little while ago about a university needing to be a better place than its environment, the unfortunate truth is that The university is a microcosm of its society. We live in that society, our students come to us from that society, and their values and our values will reflect, sometimes even lag behind, those of our society. Now, when addressing the issue of quality, we have to put it in the context of Sri Lankan society and its recent history. Since the 1970s, over 40 years ago, when I was an undergraduate at this institution, the very fabric of Sri Lankan society had been torn apart by 3 decades of civil strife, domestic unrest, a general breakdown of the rule of law, and a significant breakdown of societal values. It is absurd to assume that universities have not been affected by this. We were affected both indirectly in terms of the values of the people who entered the system, and in a very direct way, like the rest of the society, by the loss of so many intellectuals. After all, we are a community of intellectuals, and many of us, not only the Tamil intellectuals, but intellectuals from other communities, fled the country, never to return. An atmosphere of fear was created, where people were scared to speak up. That continues in various fora within the university system, faculty boards, senates, other gatherings. I have seen people who did not want to get up and say what they felt. They didn't want to speak frankly, they nodded their heads at everything. But if you were prepared to speak up after the meeting was over, a lot of people would gather around you and say, what a wonderful thing you said. That culture of reluctance to speak out continues, even here at the University of Colombo. In fact, maybe particularly at the University of Colombo. And of course, everything in the country became politicized to an extent that was unprecedented, at least in Sri Lanka, and that includes the university managements. I don't think I need to say more. So all this affected quality, the quality of the institutions, the quality of the people who worked at those institutions, and the quality of the people who graduated from those institutions. That is inevitable, okay? But we can argue, okay, that's history. All this happened years ago. It's more than 8 years now since the end of the Civil War, more than 25 years since the JVP uprising of the late 1980s was put down. And that actually had a bigger impact in many ways than the Civil War. And in fact, I would say that compared to the other countries in the region, our qualities actually, I'm damning it with faint praise, but it's not bad. I have seen at first hand some of the products of Indian universities, professionals, academics. I worked with many of them when I was on sabbatical at Fiji National University, and frankly, I was not impressed. So I think that here in Sri Lanka, we do a fairly good job. That is not to say that it can't be better. There's a lot of room for improvement, and we have to work on this if we are going to continue to make demands of our society about resources for education and so forth. We have to show that those resources are going to be well managed. Okay, let's look at some of the factors that affect quality and perhaps give us some room for improvement. Some of these factors are beyond our control. I will address them first. I'm not saying that it's a good thing or a bad thing. It just is. In the mid-1970s, when I entered the university population, that is the undergraduate students, genuinely were an elite. The best of the best were selected by the A-level system, admittedly a very one-dimensional system, because you basically entered the university based on your ability to memorize answers to A-level questions. But nevertheless, people who are extremely good at doing that got into the university. By the year 2010, and this is the last year for which I actually have any data, the undergraduate population had increased by a factor of 7. The population of the country had increased by only 50% during that same 35 years. So what that means is that a much higher percentage of school students completing their A-level were entering the university, and they were no longer necessarily the best of the best, right? Some students who were coming in were not as good, struggled. We have seen more students failing exams, unheard of almost in my day. I don't intend that as a criticism. It is what it is, that we need to provide a greater level of education to a larger percentage of our population in the hope that they can better their lives. And inevitably, that will result in a certain degradation of quality. Of course, our lecturer population is drawn from that student population. Again, we need to keep that in mind. Then, there are other policies over which we have very little control, and those include policies developed by the government on how to expand the university system. The government has, among other things anyway, gone to a lot of trouble and expense to establish universities in regions throughout the country. There's at least one university in every province. Sounds good, doesn't it? Who could possibly object to that? But if you analyze the situation carefully, it was probably a mistake. The main justification for doing that is the idea that a university in a particular province, in say, a remote area, will serve the needs of that province, will give special consideration in admissions, perhaps, to students from that province. That hasn't happened. And all these universities are simply one of many within the whole UGC system, and the UGC decides centrally who goes where and allocates students from Sinhala-speaking regions to Jaffna, and so on. Right, so these are simply universities like any other universities. But when you establish a university in a province, in addition to the infrastructure, the buildings, all the other resources that go into it, you have to worry about the human resources. Where are the lecturers going to come from? And we all know that the regional universities have struggled to staff themselves. And this has been reflected in the fact that students avoid those universities if they possibly can. Today, there are places going a begging in virtually every university. Students are not going to those universities. I feel that the situation would have been better if a lot of those resources had been allocated to expanding and developing the already established universities in Colombo, Kandy, and of course Jaffna. There have been other political decisions that we have no control over, or at least appear to have no control over, which nevertheless affect our quality as academics and our productivity. For example, there's a blatant political interference in the hiring of the non-academic staff. We cannot simply advertise and hire whom we want based on their qualifications. We are told by the powers that be which programs to offer new faculties, with sometimes programs that are not well thought out. I don't want to get into details, but to me the most significant of these programs are the new programs in technology being offered by faculties in many universities, including our own. This is an attempt to teach applied science to students who have no background in basic science. Moreover, these faculties have been handed over to science faculty personnel to manage. And frankly, we scientists only know how to teach science. So I'm not quite sure where these technology faculties are going. And I greatly fear that they will prove to be a very expensive mistake. Meanwhile, they are a distraction. They are taking our time, and I don't know what the quality of the product will be like. Then we have a few other factors that have to do with administration and management of the universities, and this also affects our quality as intellectuals. The management systems that prevail in our universities, and exactly why they prevail is not clear to me, whether that's a matter of law or simply the way it has always been. But they are hopelessly inadequate to deal with universities of the size and complexity that many of our established universities are now achieving. And that includes Colombo, certainly includes Peradeniya, it certainly includes Sri Jayavardhanapura, and maybe others. These universities are becoming very large, very complex entities, right? But they are still managed in a very, very centralized and inefficient manner. And we end up wasting a lot of our time and becoming less productive as a result of that. Right now, we are being over-regulated. I can speak for the University of Colombo, I won't speak for other universities, by a bureaucracy that is staffed by individuals who are increasingly timid and indecisive and in some cases downright incompetent. And we seem to be unable to do anything about it. But as academics, this takes up a huge amount of our time and it lessens our productivity and the quality of the product. So okay, I took my bash at the factors outside us as individuals. Now let's address ourselves, okay? Self-criticism. The quality of our academic staff is very negatively affected, in my humble opinion, by the fact that we, collectively speaking, do not have enough exposure to the outside world. Obviously, this varies from discipline to discipline, from faculty to faculty, but it's generally the case. The established universities tend to hire their own graduates. This practice is completely antithetical to what you would find in the United States, where as a matter of policy, universities won't hire their own graduates. They believe in bringing in fresh blood, fresh ideas, and not perpetuating the same old, as they say. Many of our academics are recruited immediately after their basic degrees, and they do their postgraduate degrees in the same university or other local universities on a part-time basis. This is not a way to achieve quality, right? It is perpetuating mediocrity because there are no fresh ideas coming in, no people exposed to a completely different system in another country, and even to the extent that they're exposed to another university in Sri Lanka, that is not a great source of fresh ideas either, because unfortunately, we have evolved a system in Sri Lanka where the universities are all clones of each other. Now, let me elaborate on that. Our universities do not have enough competition, either internal or external. The state sector universities are not autonomous, at least not even autonomous to the extent that they should be autonomous. And I understood what Professor Uyangudu was getting at, right, when he spoke about the kinds of autonomy that we do not want. But even the kinds of autonomy that we want, we don't have. We are all centrally controlled by the University Grants Commission, and the University Grants Commission is doing its best to turn us all into clones of one another. UGC regulations are, to a great extent, outdated, but they govern every aspect of hiring and promoting academic staff. The UGC even dictates which programs we are going to offer, even to the extent of naming the degrees that we are supposed to grant. What has happened to our senates? the law. The University Act of 1978 specifies that the University Senate is the supreme academic body in the university. What happened to the authority that that carries? We have allowed it to erode. We are quite happy to let the UGC dictate to us, and we go around with the impression that their dictates are law and we cannot possibly challenge them. And we do not treat them as suggestions or guidelines, we treat them as law, and that has been accepted to the point where even the, I'm not sure whether the chairman of the UGC is here today, I know he was expected to come, but if he's here, he needs to hear this, right? They basically see themselves as the University of Sri Lanka with branch campuses. So even going to another university is not exposing yourself to the kind of variety that the system really demands. Now, the latest thing that we are having to deal with is the SLQF, the Sri Lanka Quality Framework. When it was first developed a few years ago, it was actually a good idea. Just developed as a set of guidelines that would allow universities to set certain standards. But by default, mostly because we all allowed it to happen, it has become a set of rigid rules that all of us are now expected to follow. When we develop a new program, we don't worry about whether the program makes academic sense, whether it does the correct thing in the correct way, and whether it meets the needs of the country. What we worry about is, does it meet some SLQF standard for a particular level? Does it meet the criteria for SLQF level 6? We ask ourselves. And then some of us say, well, we go far beyond what SLQF level 6 requires, so why don't we demand to be called SLQF level 7? I believe this is now happening in medical schools. So these are all ways in which we march in lockstep with the rest, to misquote Bertolt Brecht. There simply isn't enough diversity among the state sector universities, so if competition is going to come, it's got to be from outside. Well, where is the outside? The competition from the private sector in higher education is extremely limited. The most of the private sector institutions are not universities. They are franchises of some foreign university, granting the foreign university's degree. They don't even have the trappings of a real university. They don't promote research. They don't promote any scholarly work. They don't promote a professional life or career for their staff. In fact, they are mostly depending on visitors. But they're completely divorced and almost invisible to the university community. Of course, they exist. We cannot neglect their existence. What the country needs and lacks, and has lacked for a long time, is a vibrant and dynamic private sector in higher education that is based ideally on non-profit institutions, granting their own degrees, local degrees, not somebody else's degrees, in competition with the state sector, but free to do it their own way, not tied down to the UGC's regulations and rules and systems and methods, but doing different things in their own way so that different ideas can get around. Now, I know I'm making myself very unpopular in certain quarters by saying this, because many of you are adamantly opposed to the idea of private universities. But I believe that we need them. And while I have a lot of respect for what the free education system in Sri Lanka has achieved since the 1950s, it really begs the question of how much more we could have achieved if a system of private, non-profit universities had been encouraged to develop alongside the state sector the same way that they have always been there in secondary education. Well, I can go on about that, but I'm running out of time and I can see Thilan getting agitated. So a couple more quick points, Thilan. One of the items that affects our quality is an ever more finely articulated and detailed point scheme for the promotion of academics. Right now, I have already sort of said a few words about that, so I'm not going to say much more except that such a point scheme actually influences and in fact skews the very thing it attempts to measure. And you create a point scheme, everybody works to get the maximum number of points, not to develop the best quality. And then, of course, there's the innate conservatism of academics. Believe it or not, we are very conservative. We don't like to change. We want everything to be the way it was when we were students or when we were young lecturers. But the world is changing. Our society is changing very fast, and we are very slow to keep up with these changes. A few words, Tilan, about the topic of integrity, which was in the topic, but I haven't said very much about it. I don't want to say too much. Most of us have it. The academic community, by and large, possesses integrity. Right? We are not doing enough to propagate the notions of integrity and academic ethics and values. Universities have been very slow about making ethics part of the curriculum. The medical faculties are doing it, but not the rest of us. Because we are a microcosm of our society, we do have some internal problems. And we always have, we have now today, we've always had, a few academics who are prepared to act selfishly and in a very unethical manner to achieve their personal goals, and that we accept. The real problem is that the rest of us don't do anything about it. We are honest ourselves, but we have a very laissez-faire attitude towards ethics violations on the part of others, including our students, by the way. And I think of it as the Anne Pau syndrome. We don't want to take action because, damn sin, right? We have to actually punish somebody. We don't like to do that. So we let it go. But that is also wrong, and it is affecting our quality as well as our integrity. The most common issues I have observed are plagiarism, which is very popular and very common among our students, and which as academics we are not paying sufficient attention to. And the other is conflicts of interest. And we have seen conflicts of interest in this university under the previous two administrations, which I don't need to say anything about because all of us are painfully familiar with that. And so Tilan is about to chase me from here, so I will conclude my few words. No brickbats so far. Thank you very much.
Thank you, R.D. Well, R.D. is a name that we use, Ranil. Thank you, Dr. Gunarathne. I think he was determined to keep me standing for 5 minutes. No matter what time I come, he's going to speak 5 more minutes so I can stand there for 5 minutes. And also, he was lucky that Professor Mohandasula somehow couldn't make it. I know. Maybe I was thinking actually Professor Uyangoda and yourself both probably sent the transcript beforehand so he could decide whether to come or not. I was wondering about that. Before I get to Dr. Gunaruwan, let me mention a couple of things in RD's speech. Actually, he mentioned about the technology faculty, and as one of the people from the science faculty who is involved with the technology faculty, I should say, I think, you know, I agree with you in the sense that, you know, the definition is not there, but the very reason why I think in the Columbia University, mostly the science faculty people are involved in that, because that is the closest thing that they can do with the courses that we define or we create for the technology faculty. And other than that, I think what they are doing is their technology stream that they started with the A-level, so they have to somehow cater to that, so therefore they have to come up with something. That is basically the way I see it. And since it is there, we will just do it. We'll somehow start it and then maybe get it on the right track. And I think in the producing intellectuals, so the education system of the universities, the professor Arjuna Parakram is here, so he can correct me if I'm wrong. If you look at the origin of the words, even the word education, coming from Latin, and I think in French also, douceré or something, some word going close by to that, The real meaning is breeding or bringing up or rearing. So education means that. So then in that context, if you look at the term free education, then you start wondering what that means, because breeding, bringing up or rearing, it is almost an automatic thing in the animal kingdom. So therefore, if it is something given free, then we have to think twice before we...